Hi, my name is Kim York, Chief Marketing Officer at Ascend Federal Credit Union.
And I'm Trish Christ, CEO of Nashville Education, Community and Arts Television.
Our goal in collaborating with NECAT is to share the richness of the arts with adults and children statewide who may not be able to attend special performances and events in person.
I grew up an artsy kid in small town Tennessee, and I would have loved to experience wildly creative arts and music like the program you're about to see, captured by NECAT's team at Oz Arts Nashville.
This episode is one of a growing collection Ascend is proud to make possible through NECAT. Click the Watch TV button at necatnetwork.org to find more original local programming on arts, education, and teen money management.
We'll be adding new shows and new episodes all the time, so keep checking back. Thank you, Ascend and Kim, for caring about the arts, about education, music, teenagers, careers, opportunities, and local television.
Enjoy the show.
My name is Paul Dresher, and for us today will be a piece called The Sound Maze. I started inventing musical instruments when I was in high school. I was passionate about music starting from when I was around 12 or 13 years old. I wanted to be a rock star, but I was always interested in experimental music and sort of the fringe of rock and roll, like Jimi Hendrix using feedback and playing his guitar in all these different ways. I wanted to get a 12-string guitar, which was in the mid-1960s, because I liked the sound of that. And my parents instead of giving me a 12-string guitar for Christmas, they gave me a guitar kit, a kit for building your own 12-string guitar. And this thing looked awful. It was like a box. It was a square box. And I said, I didn't want that. So I redesigned the whole thing physically and made a kind of psychedelic guitar. And it was incredibly satisfying. And when I brought it to school, it was over Christmas break, when I brought it to school, I got all kinds of attention. And I also really enjoyed the fact that I had to discover what the instrument could do, because it actually didn't do what I hoped it would do. It did different things. And that really elicited a process of inventing is like having an idea, trying it out, making something, and then seeing what you've got, and then having a dialogue with it as it evolves over time. So I started to build instruments at that point and started to make that a regular part of my musical exploration. At this point, inventing instruments is a combination of my interest in composing, and it's about discovering new sounds or new ways to create new physical ways of performing sounds that we already may are be familiar with, but that could be created in new ways. So in the case of this instrument here, this is an instrument called the hurdy-gurdy, or hurdy-grande, but it's related to a medieval folk instrument, and it uses one of the things that a hurdy-gurdy does, which has a wheel that bows strings. And in a traditional hurdy-gurdy, the string sort of just sits on the turning wheel, which would be a hand crank in a traditional instrument, and it would make a drone sound, sort of like this. Well, that became a little bit boring quickly for me, and I said, there's got to be another way to play this, and I discovered that if you keep the string a little bit above the wheel, so it's not touching, but if you press the string to the wheel, you can actually get it to play in a very, that there's no other instrument that I know of that does this. And then you can make completely different kinds of techniques. And so that's a very beautiful sound, but this thing can also make very aggressive sounds. So as a composer, I'm fascinated by the range of things that an instrument can do. So in this case, it's about discovering new sounds. And in some of these instruments, though, are less instruments, they're more like sculptures. And so they do one thing that's really fascinating, and it's a mechanical process. So it's different, it's coming up with different ways to explore sound and visualization and movement. One comes at in musical instrument inventing, or really kind of any creative process, from a variety of different directions. And sometimes you have the idea first in your imagination. Sometimes it's about just finding an object and wondering what could this object do. So we sort of attack it from both directions, particularly when you're making a big project like the Sound Maze, where it has lots of different parts. And each part might evolve in a different way. So in the case of the instrument that we have over here on the far side, the octagon, one of my collaborators, and a lot of my work is collaborative. I shouldn't pretend that this is just all my pieces, that I built everything here and all the ideas in here are mine. I have a wonderful group of people that I work with, particularly a gentleman named Daniel Schmidt, who I've been building instruments with since the 1970s, and we are very complementary. We have different sorts of skills, and we have, just like musicians have jam sessions, Daniel and I have jam sessions where we just jump ideas, and somebody has an idea and somebody has an improvement on that idea. And they say, yeah, but if we did that, then we could do this too. And so in like 2 hours, we'll often evolve a whole design that if one of us was working on it alone, we'd never get there. And so in this case, Daniel went shopping to a thrift store. And we often find that going to thrift stores and junkyards and things like that yield really interesting results, because there's a lot of industrial detritus and materials that are made for one purpose that might have very interesting applications in another way, completely unintended. So we're always looking for those opportunities. So in the case of, there's a ring over there that you see on this octagon-shaped platform. And that ring actually was from a clothing rack. And it turns out that we were able to integrate that ring into multiple purposes in the music theater piece, Schick Machine. And spinning them, of course, is one way. Using it as an electrical conductor, because it is metallic, is another way. So that you just discover things in different ways. The origin of the pipe organ in this project is kind of interesting and emblematic of one way things happen. I got this phone call while we were working on this design and a few others, and it was from the Sonoma Community Center. Sonoma is a small town about 50 miles north of San Francisco, and they told me this story, that they had a trustee who was passionate about pipe organs. This was about 50 years ago. He raised the money and they assembled sort of an organ out of different fragmented parts inexpensively, because they were not a wealthy institution, and he ran an organ program there for 40 years. He passed away, and the organ program fell apart, as did the physical organ. It stopped working, and there was nobody there who had the interest or the resources to keep the organ program going or to repair the organ. And they said, so we want to get rid of it. We hear you do stuff with invented musical instruments. Would you like to have the organ? And I said, well, I know nothing about pipe organs, but I am interested in trying to find a way to integrate wind. You know, in most of my designs here, you have percussion instruments and stringed instruments, and of course, music can be made beautifully from wind instruments as well, and we didn't have any in our project. So I said, well, this is a different idea than a trumpet or a flute, but maybe we could do something with a pipe organ. So I went up there and looked at it and made the decision that we would take the organ. So I brought my crew of three or four people and a big rented truck, and we spent 3 days disconnecting, tearing apart the organ. Now, since we didn't know anything about how organs worked at that point, we had to document things very carefully, take lots of photos, make notations on the pipes and on different things, because we didn't know how we were going to reconstruct this thing. And so we basically went through this process of discovery, first doing the historical research and then trying to find out what did we have, because organs have many different manifestations. So it was a many month-long process, and then we had to, of course, decide, well, how are we going to use it? How are we going to do unique things that aren't the traditional keyboard playing? Because Steve is a percussionist, we figured out whether one way we wanted to play was with mallets. So we came up with a way to play the organ percussively, which is, of course, not the traditional way. And then we also had to come up with a way for the organ to play itself, and we came up with what is essentially like a giant music box way to play the pipe organ. I first heard about Oz from my agent, the woman Sue Bernstein, who represents my ensemble when we have bookings and tourings and commissions around the country. And she came and saw the facility and met Lauren very soon after it opened, or even while they were still dusting off the construction debris. And she said, this is an amazing facility. And she kept telling me about it. And Sue said, it's going to be inspiring to you. And the story behind it is wonderful. And so when Lauren heard about the Sound Maze, I think she decided it would be a really appropriate and perfect match for what Oz is trying to do with Family Day. And so when we first did Sound Maze back in April in San Francisco, Russ, the production manager, the technical director of the theater, came out to San Francisco and saw the facility, saw what we were doing, and the match between us and him was perfect. And he completely got it, and I got the sense that this is an institution that is dedicated to the same things that we are, to art as a way of life, to asking questions, to exploring, to discovery. And when we arrived here, we were instantly confirmed that that was what was going on here. The facility is an amazing resource. The staff here, everyone that we've dealt with, is just passionate about the mission, and it's just been a sheer pleasure to work here, and I'm just looking forward to meeting your audience now for the first time.
Thank you.
The Sound Maze originated out of two music theater works that I did over the last 15 years that involved large-scale invented musical instruments, many of which you see behind me here. And at the end of every performance, we would invite the audience on stage to experiment with the instruments themselves. And of course, they were often very inspired to see, how did we do that? How does that instrument work? How does that sound come about? And after doing this for a number of years, I said, you know, it would be really thrilling to actually make that the focus of what we do, to invite the audience on stage and to have that be almost like a visual art installation, but an interactive one. So the idea for the Sound Maze started as a way to just bring the audience directly to the instruments and have them be able to have a chance to be creative with them, to experiment with them, get their hands dirty, and to do the sort of the process that I do when I first encounter a new design.
Nashville is such a creative community. It's just great to have a place like this that explores these different kinds of arts and gives us a chance to expose our kids to it.
What I liked about this is, you know, like the music and the drama.
And arts is always important for the kids because creativity is part of everything. I mean, I don't care if it's science, math, history, whatever. I mean, arts spurs creativity, so this is definitely important.
I love the diversity that they have for all the kids and hands-on. It makes it real fun for all. It's a great family event.
It's a great chance for the kids to see instruments that are unconventional, and for them to see them up close and then see them how they're meant to be used. So kids need to learn the value of art early on. Music, visual arts, and to learn an appreciation for the world around them.
Joy, excitement, fun. What else can you want? I mean, you have to solve puzzles. This is an engineering feat. It's not just sound. It's wonderful.
It's fun and it's nice to listen to when you're
Wow, that was amazing. Where have you seen anything like that before?
It was fantastic in person, and I'm so glad others will get to see it on TV. Our thanks to Ascend Federal Credit Union for making this broadcast possible.
Ascend is proudly involved in the communities we serve in a wide variety of areas relating to the arts, educational opportunities, the environment, health, and even sports. We are the exclusive credit union of Blue Raider Athletics and Vanderbilt Athletics. And each year we support a variety of charitable organizations, including the Susan G. Komen Foundation, the Leukemia and Lymphoma Society's Costume for a Cure program, Ronald McDonald House Charities in Nashville, the Monroe Carroll Junior Children's Hospital at Vanderbilt, Warm Coats from Warm Hearts with WSMV Channel 4 in Nashville, and so many others. Just as NECAT helps enrich lives through arts and educational programming, Ascend's brand promises to educate and help members become effective financial stewards. And we have been keeping that promise since 1951. To learn more about Ascend, visit us at ascendfcu.org.
On behalf of everyone at NECAT and at Ascend, thank you for watching.